This is WBSM On Demand. It's time for South Coast Now with Chris McCarthy. Streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Text us using App Chat on the WBSM app. Now, Chris McCarthy.
Good morning. So I want to thank you for joining me. It's a beautiful day out there. It's a little chilly, but they say it's going to get a lot warmer as, you know, the sun gets higher in the sky. So that should be a good day for us. So make sure you get out there, get a little exercise. Remember, activity is good for the mind. It's good for the body. So it really helps you emotionally if you are going through something. All right. So I'm not talking to anybody in specifically. I'm just talking to everybody, right? Including myself. So, good morning. We have a big meeting tonight. Hopefully Leo Troquette will make it, and he's probably in line at the donut shop right now, if he's smart. And we'll see Leo a little bit later this morning to talk about his big meeting tonight. Just a brief rally the troops type of thing. Again, folks, you don't have town meetings in the city of New Bedford. And that's okay. That's how your government is. And we have them in the towns. I know, like, Freetown is an open town meeting. If you're a registered voter, you can show up to town meeting. Here in Fairhaven, you got to get elected, but it's not hard at all. In fact, there's always openings. So if you wanted to, you could get on town meeting here in Fairhaven. Dartmouth, I believe, is also an elected town meeting. I think Lakeville is an open town meeting. Anyway, New Bedford, you have city councilors who are trying to give you an opportunity to speak in a town meeting format, all right? Doesn't have the power of town meetings, doesn't have the legal authority, but I think it's very important. This development started with the meeting at Keith Junior High School, okay? Organized by Sean Oliver, Ward 3 City Councilor, Leo Choquette, Ward 1 City Councilor. I think at that time he was the Ward 1 elect. No, he'd been sworn in. So, Ian Abreu, all right, a veteran at-large counselor. He was part of that committee. The three counselors, and they had some members of the council who joined them. They were the ones on stage, the organizers, and they did get one members of the Board of Assessors to show up, which was nice. They brought an employee of the assessor's office. They also brought the chief financial officer, who's a hell of a good guy, to the meeting as well to answer your questions. So Leo Choquette is continuing that. And he's holding a meeting. Now, Sean Oliver has got the Ward 3 City Council, Ward 3 community meetings that go on. Those get a lot of people at them. So what I'm saying is that you're getting a real democracy going, but it's up to you. Democracy is a contact sport. It requires citizen participation. Tonight, Leo Choquette will have a meeting in Ward 1. At the Pulaski School, I encourage all of you to go to the Pulaski School tonight, particularly if you live in Ward 1. This is a Ward 1 meeting, but I bet there's going to be a lot of talk about taxes, okay? A lot of talk about taxes. And I know there are going to be a number. Leo was good enough to invite a couple of the state invited all the state representatives who represent Ward 1, and he invited all the candidates who are running to represent Ward 1, Republicans and Democrats, Democrats and Republicans, including unenrolled. So I know, well, at least I believe, you're going to have a number of state representative candidates and state representatives at Leo's meeting tonight. I believe you'll have, well, I know Leo will be there. You may have a number of other city councilors from across the city who come up to Pulaski School tonight at 7 o'clock. So, again, folks, when people go out of their way, city councilors, who have an extraordinarily busy schedule, you know, I give them a hard time from time to time here, but I'll never give them a hard time about the fact that they have a busy schedule, all right? In fact, I get criticized for going out of my way to point out that, you know, it's okay to miss a meeting once in a while, right? Because they have such a busy schedule. But again, they're not drafted. They organized it. They ran for it. They wanted the job. But when a city council like Leo Choquette or Sean Oliver or Ian Abreu goes out of their way to organize a meeting for you people to go up and tell them about whatever it is that you're concerned about, well, if you don't show up, and if you just think the other guy's going to show up so it doesn't matter if I show up, you're wrong. You're wrong. Empty chairs, honestly, in a lot of meetings, count for more than chairs that are full. All right? Empty chairs say a lot about democracy. Empty chairs. And if you think the other guy is going to go so you don't have to go, and again, I know everyone's busy and things like that, but this is a new city councilor who's trying to ignite democracy. This will be his second meeting. So, if you can make it, make it. If you can't make it, I mean, what are you going to do, right? I won't be there. I can't make it. I don't live in Ward 1 anyway, so what would it matter? But I'll get a report from it. I'll know, and we'll talk more about it after the meeting. But you've got a number of things going on in the city of New Bedford. Yesterday, I talked about the CPA meeting coming up. It is Wednesday night. Now, it's a Zoom meeting. So that means you can watch it, but it's not going to be at City Hall. I don't think it's effective government. Government by Zoom. Government by shut-ins, right? It is. I get it. It's convenient for the city councilors. You can sit home. You never have to change into a professional outfit. You can eat bonbons and, well, drink whatever you want, really, from the comfort of your home. But I don't like it. I really don't like it. I know many of you don't like it. But you're going to get that on Wednesday night. The Finance Committee, they're going to vote on a couple million dollars in community preservation funds. Now, here's the thing. The Finance Committee meeting is the real meeting. Now, I have not been happy with past committee meetings. I got a feeling, though, you're going to see a little more action in this Finance Committee meeting. The Finance Committee meeting is the discussion of the individual projects. The work is done in committees, okay? You don't get a manual when you get elected. You got to learn from your colleagues. But some of the colleagues don't want to do work in committees. Don't want to do work at all. That's obvious. You can zoom it in. But for those of new counselors and for those of you at home that are looking, Wednesday night is the meeting. the Finance Committee meeting. You'll have to watch it on the internet. Now, I know that many of you don't have that, and so do the city councilors, but that's how they're going to do their meeting. Well, the chairman, Linda Morritt, is going to hold it by Zoom. The chairman decides where the meeting is, how the meeting's held. She's going to hold it in her house on Zoom. So, 508-996-0500. But the Finance Committee meeting on Wednesday night is the important meeting. That is where they discuss, well, if you're lucky, they discuss each project on its own merits for the tens of thousands of dollars, hundreds of thousands of dollars that each project wants. Remember, they're going to whack up over $2 million in the Finance Committee meeting. When it gets to the committee, that's a committee of the whole, but when it gets to the floor of the city council, they voted like an ominous budget. They vote the whole package, okay? Sorry, folks, I had a stroke. So sometimes my tongue doesn't cooperate. Sometimes it's amazing, but sometimes it doesn't cooperate. So they vote the whole thing on the council floor, all right? So the Finance Committee meeting. Now, if you're a city councilor, you have the prerogative to sever each individual project, which I would do. In the Finance Committee meeting, they're going to discuss it. But on the floor vote, at the final reading, someone on that city council, a couple of councilors, ought to move. Well, they can do whatever they want, but you, the taxpayer, ought to be concerned because they can vote the good with the bad and put the whole package through, the $2 million. In there will be a lot of stuff that you probably like and a couple of things you definitely don't like. So the devil is in the details. So, tonight, you've got a meeting in Ward 1 at the Pulaski School at 7 o'clock. I expect Leo Choquette will be here in a few minutes to talk about that. Then, Wednesday night, there is a meeting of the Finance Committee, which is a committee of the whole, but they're going to do it from their homes. Linda Morad wants to hold the meeting from her house. Going to hold it by Zoom, which means that if you don't have internet access or you're not interested in spending your time in front of your computer or your tablet or on your phone, you're not going to be able to see the meeting. So that is Wednesday night. The Finance Committee is going to vote on the CPA projects. So that is the subsidy for the Soba House. That's the YWCA Residential Services. They got it under historic preservation. I don't know if historically that building was a sober house, but let me tell you something. Going forward, it's going to be. So we hear the non-taxpayers of New Bedford do appreciate you people in New Bedford subsidizing sober houses. It seems at odds with what most of you are telling me you'd like to see for the city of New Bedford, but that will be Wednesday night. Then it'll go, well, if it makes it through the Finance Committee meeting, it goes to the full city council again on the floor for the final reading and the final vote. Now, when we get back, I want to talk to you about anything you want to talk to me about at 508-996-0500. But I want to bring the speech that I brought to you yesterday from our newly minted Secretary of Transportation. I want to bring it home local. I want to talk about what the governor said and what she didn't say about tolls. And I want you to think about your own existence. I want you to think about the fact that the Secretary of Transportation told us she didn't have any money. We don't have any money. We're broke. That's what she said. So she's talked about tolls. Well, the governor of Massachusetts knocked down the idea of putting tolls at the border. But I didn't hear her knock down any tolls inside. And we need a new bridge, New Bedford, Fairhaven. She told you yesterday, I brought it to you. You only get the stuff that really matters to you from me here on WBSM and my fellow hosts. Think about the fact that the state of Massachusetts is going to pay for a new bridge, Fairhaven, New Bedford Bridge. It's located in New Bedford, but, you know, we like to consider it our own too. They don't have any money. Think about that. They're broke. She wants to make tolls. The governor says no tolls at the border. Logically, what does that tell us? Folks, stick around. I'll take your calls at 508-996-0500. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy, and folks, we are talking about taxes, right? Anytime the government makes a demand on your wallet, that's a tax. You can call it a fee, you can call it a toll, service charge, whatever. They are really good with coming up with words that don't sound like tax, but that's what it is, okay? It's a tax. If you have to go to Logan Airport, you pay a tax, okay? If you don't have a Easy Pass, which is a computerized chip in your car that the gantry reads, and they've got your credit card already, they're going to send you a bill because they get your license plate. I know, because when I was working at Boston Hour Radio, there was a really nice young guy there who worked there who, you know, he's like a regular, he wasn't a college kid, he was an intern with us, but I think he's from Chicago or something. Anyway, he needed a ride to the airport. So I gave him a ride one morning after I got off the air. I said, I'll drop you at the airport, you know. And I remember driving in and thinking, well, of course, I remember when there was no tolls to Logan Airport. So, but, you know, a couple days later, a couple weeks later, whatever, Natalie and I got a bill in the mail. No, I got it because I was thinking I'm just driving my car, but she opens my mail. Because Lord knows I'm not going to do it. So she said, did you take someone to the airport? And I said, yeah. And she said, who? Who'd you take to the airport? And so then, you know, that initiated a conversation. But anyway, the governor of Massachusetts has said that she wants to raise local taxes, okay? Your auto excise, she doesn't want to do it. She wants to give your local officials the power to raise taxes. John Mitchell has said he's not going to do it. He doesn't need to do it now, but he'd like the tool to have, right? I appreciate the mayor's honesty. Members of the city council have said they don't want that power. Well, except for Shane Burgo and Joe Lopes. Those two want the power to tax your excise tax, your auto excise tax. They are at loggerheads with Senator Montigny. Thank God Senator Montigny is on our side on this one. He was on our side with the gas tax, too. He opposed increasing the gas tax. Senator Montigny opposed increasing the gas tax. Governor Healey wants to launder tax increases through your local board of selectmen, your mayor's office, right? She doesn't want to do it. But her Secretary of Transportation, the very unfiltered Monica Nutt, Monica Nutt, who's the Secretary of Transportation, I played her clips yesterday. She says, I'm going after the money. I'm going to charge more for Ubers and Lyfts, and I'm going to take your driver's license if you don't pay. I'm paraphrasing. And, not much though, and I want tolls. I want tolls. We're broke, she says. We don't have any money. We're broke. She's the Secretary of Transportation. The governor yesterday knocked down the creation of tolls at the state borders, Rhode Island and New Hampshire, New York, Connecticut, Vermont. I guess even a little bit in Maine, right? So you understand. That would be because the governor would have to erect those. It would obviously be a state tax. She doesn't want that. Politically, she doesn't want that. So how do they get more money for a bridge in New Bedford? How do they get more money for a bridge in New Bedford? The Secretary of Transportation, the very unfiltered Monica Nutt, and I appreciate that about her. Can you imagine what she'd be like? You get a couple of gin and tonics in her. If you missed that clip, you should check out the podcast from yesterday. Maybe I'll play a little bit of it today. It was ponderous. It was torture to my listeners, but I think the information is important. It was so important the governor told everybody yesterday, just hours after I played it here, that she's not for border tolls. But Monica Nutt, our Secretary of Transportation, she is very enthusiastic about tolls. But the governor says no tolls at the border. But we do have a toll going into Logan Airport, right? We have a toll going into Logan Airport. Well, we need a lot of money for the New Bedford Bridge. The Secretary of Transportation told us we're broke. I played the clip for you yesterday. Her initial impulses, I don't know if she thinks much, but her impulse, she blurted out, I'm going to put tolls at the border. The governor, who unbelievably says, I still have full confidence in my Secretary of Transportation, but I don't agree with her border tolls. What does that tell you? We need money for the Fairhaven-New Bedford Bridge, although it is solely under the control of the state and within the borders of the city of New Bedford. What does that tell you? What does that tell you? No border tolls. We're broke. New Bedford, Fairhaven, you need money for a new bridge. It's coming through the state. You still pay taxes to use the highways to get into Logan Airport. What does that tell you? I got some people on hold. If you'd like to join the conversation, you can at 508-996-0500. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
Yeah, good morning, Chris.
What's happening?
You know what that tells me? They're lying to us again. They're pulling wool over your eyes. We have $8 billion in surplus, $850 million in escrow account, ARPA, and she's telling us we're broke. You know why Maura Healey changed her tune? Because Gene Bellicenti had an interview with Rhode Island State President Dominic Ruggiero.
Yes.
And he said if the state of Massachusetts does that, then they would pass a retaliatory toll tax on Massachusetts, starting with commercial vehicles. And depending on the legislation in Massachusetts, they would consider other vehicles. That's what it is. And then Maura Healey, because of all the pushback from the New Hampshire governor and Rhode Island politicians, she decided to, she said that Monica Tibbetts nuts spoke out of turn.
Yes.
That she has no, and she has no, she's not going to impose any type of, she has no, not going to impose a tax. No. So this whole thing is she runs roughshod and says whatever she wants, and then the governor's got to do cleanup.
So I appreciate the call. The reality of it is that the, and I appreciate that gentleman's analysis of the situation. I would agree with him that the retaliatory taxes, they are pushing the governor around. In other words, her Secretary of Transportation goes out, makes these claims, and she totally is out of her mind, right? Obviously, you heard that clip. And she, this is her first job in government. Maura Healey never should have appointed to this position. That, but elections have consequences. I voted. You know how I voted. The only thing you can do is vote yourself a Republican from this district, whatever district you live in. Vote a Republican in to the House of Representatives. If there's one on the ballot, by God, give him a chance. Okay? Your prosperity depends on it. The reason that Maura Healey knocked this down is because it would require her to raise taxes. She doesn't want to do that. She wants to launder the tax raising through the local officials. She wants to make someone else do it for her. And there are many out there that are willing to do it. Look at Shane Burgo. Look at Joe Lopes. They're all enthusiastic for the new auto excise tax. They're so enthusiastic, they're going against the grain of their colleagues for once. Well, I shouldn't say that because Shane does go against the grain quite a bit. He is a man with his own, well, yeah, quite frankly, his own political party. They call the Shane Denistas. But Shane will be in here. He's got courage. He'll be in here next Monday with me and you, taking your calls at 508-996-0500. No, what I think, folks, is going on is that you're going to see local tolls, much like the one that you pay to go to Logan Airport. Okay? New projects are going to see new tolls. It is not a coincidence. Well, maybe, I don't know. Bill Strauss suddenly decided to retire. Abruptly, handing it off to Mark Sylvia, his hand-chosen successor. Is that because, as the chairman of transportation, the House of Representatives, he sees what's coming down the pike and he doesn't want to do it, so he hands it off to Mark Sylvia to do it for him? He's the Democrat running for Bill Strauss's seat. The seat that nobody realized was going to be vacant. Bill Strauss waited till the last minute to alert, which I think is bad for democracy, but maybe when Representative Strauss found out the plans for this area, he said, I can't go along with that. Even though I live in Mattapoisett, I know a lot of people that use the New Bedford Bridge. Remember, the governor said no new tolls at the border. Very specific, no border tolls. 508-996-05. I don't get a couple of people on hold. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
Good morning, Chris. Two questions. One related to what you're talking about, and one a little more personal, but quick. What are the qualifications of the person appointed as Secretary of Transportation? And secondly, what is the name of your theme song? I can't get the words, so I'll hang up and listen.
Sure. So it's a song by Rush, the great group from the 80s. Thanks for the call. So that's the theme song for the entry music to the program. We have, quite frankly, the selection for who our cabinet secretary is solely up to the governor. So Maura Healey selected Monica Nutt. I would assume the lieutenant governor has some input, but constitutionally, it is an appointment of the governor, Governor Healey, which is why, and believe me, I don't mind it when you do it. Well, that's not true. Sometimes I do. It hurts. But that is why I voted for Maura Healey, if you'll remember, and I say it, and in fact, some of my friends kid me about it. You do penance every time, but I feel it's important to say it. I voted for Maura Healey. I voted for her because I believed after 8 years as the attorney general, doing serious things, that she would make serious decisions and select serious people to run all the very important agencies that the state has, right? I didn't think that Jeff Deal, with his very thin resume and work ethic, would be able to attract the kind of quality people that a governor has to attract. I still stand by that statement about Jeff Deal, but I'm sorry to say that I was wrong about Maura Healey, at least in this occasion. The woman she selected, Monica Nutt, she's very odd. I mean, like, I appreciate for the sake of my program that she's so unfiltered, but she's a dangerous person. Her attitude is dangerous about the taxpayers, about her powers, about her lust for power. It's very clear. It's coming through in her voice. You hear it. You play, when I played it, you heard it. So really, the governor selects him. That's it. And that's what happened. And the governor has made a statement that says she has full confidence in her. Would you have full confidence in that person? I wouldn't hire her to be a babysitter. But she's in charge of billions of dollars, right down to your automobile, your personal automobile, your trains, your highways, your roads, and your New Bedford Bridge. She's broke. She said, we're broke, and I want tolls. The governor says, no tolls at the border. Well, New Bedford, Fairhaven, think about it. Stick around. We'll be right back. That's the Beatles being sarcastic for me. Obviously, I have real reservations with what the Democrat governor of Massachusetts, Maura Healey, is doing in her appointees, who she's like daily having to rein in, you know? So, 508-996-0500. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
Hey, sometimes you feel like a nut, sometimes you don't. I've enjoyed these good nuts. Mounds don't.
I'd like mounds better now.
Hey, you know, I don't know what these politicians are thinking. They just want to tax you to death.
Yes.
They're forcing people out of the state, probably forcing businesses out of the state, too. I really don't know what they're thinking. I don't think they listen to the people at all, the average people, the average Joes around. And I don't know. They just got a totally different concept of what's going on.
Well, here's the thing. They listen to the voters. And if you take a city like New Bedford, where they majority vote Democrat like religiously, and a lot of people just don't even vote anymore, okay?
Yeah, so, I think in New Bedford people have gotten, you know, tired of it. And I'm praying that since the mayor went over to the Holy Land, he had a catharsis or something while he was over there. And comes back and says, I'm going to cut that budget to make sure I stay underneath $500 million. You know, it would really make my day.
I don't know, because the... But we'll find out. But the thing I'm thinking about, my friend...
Tomorrow.
Yeah. And listen, I got Leo here. If you want to call me back
in the next hour... One last thing.
No, call me back in the next hour if you can. The fact of the matter is that there's no better place to erect tolls than New Bedford. You guys vote Democrat religiously, and then the rest of you don't even bother to vote. Actually, most of you don't even vote. So where could you erect tolls if you can't put them at the border? Right on the New Bedford Bridge, the brand new bridge. Now coming in is Leo Choquette. Leo, Ward 1 City Council, what do you got tonight?
All right, so hi, Chris. Hi, everybody out there. I wanted to say thank you for letting me promote tonight's event on the radio on WBSM, Chris McCarthy Show. So tonight at 7 p.m., Pulaski School on 1097 Braley Road in New Bedford, we have the first neighborhood meeting for Ward 1 in many years. And since the sound of my voice is most likely not enough to get, you know, everyone to attend, I've packed five political candidates for state office into the lineup.
Nice.
So, again, running for the retiring state rep Bill Strauss's seat, we've got Mark Sylvia, Democrat, Fairhaven Town Moderator. We have Joe Pyers, Republican, who's an old Rochester Regional School Committee man. And then also Bob McConnell, who is the state committee man for the Republicans. He's Republican. So, I mean, those are some pretty heavy hitters.
Yes. But also you have...
But wait, there's more.
Right.
also running for the seat being vacated by retiring state rep Paul Schmidt, we've got Stephen Ouellette. He's a Democrat, and he's a Westport selectman. We have Jesse St. Gervais, who's running as an independent, and he's a successful local businessman. Mm-hmm. And then I reached out to Evan Gendro, but I guess he's not...
He's not running.
So I don't know who the Republican is who's running, and if they're out there or if someone knows them, please... Tell them to come tonight.
Yes. And you've also got Chris Hendricks and Chris Markey, right?
Chris Markey, yep. So state reps Chris Hendricks and Chris Markey will also be there to answer any state-related questions. And, you know, I'm going to have an open question and answer, Mike. And I'm also planning on giving a state of the ward update.
So you want to hear from people who are paying to live in Ward 1, who are paying tax in Ward 1. And because you're coming up on the budget season. That's what you want to really hear about, right, Leo?
Yes. Yeah, it was going to be exciting.
And you're working on that, all the traffic problems you've got in Ward 1.
Yep, we got a lot of traffic problems going on. We got, again, the New York China Buffet, which I'm...
Pine Grove Pharmacy, yeah.
The old Pine Grove Pharmacy. I'm committed to, you know, making sure the city enforces every and all, you know, code violations and that gentleman cleans up his act.
Where is the meeting again and what time?
It's going to be at Pulaski Elementary School, 1097 Braley Road. It's that elementary school where there's always a traffic nightmare.
Right.
So folks probably know where it is.
But it won't be a traffic nightmare at 7 o'clock. No, it might be, though,
well,
this meeting. We don't know.
If we have a good turnout, God, you know, God.
But, Leo, how important is it people go?
It's very important. Ward 1 has been the only ward in the city that has not had a neighborhood meeting in many years. And it's kind of an embarrassment to me.
But you're going to bring that back. All right, Leo, I appreciate you stopping by to promote the meeting. And thanks, my friend. He'll be back Friday to tell us how the meeting went and how the city council meeting on Thursday night went. So, folks, stick around. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program. You're going to need a ticket to ride, I think, to get over the new Fairhaven Bridge. We heard from the Secretary of Transportation, and we've heard from the governor. No tolls at the border. The governor put a kibosh on that. But the Secretary of Transportation, the very Democrat, Monica Nutt, told us that she's all about tolls, all about getting the money from the people that have the money, which is you and me, and... We're broke. Now, we know that she's going to sign off on the New Bedford Bridge, and the people of New Bedford religiously vote Democrat. or they don't vote at all. The majority of you don't even bother to vote, not you in the audience. The majority of your neighbors don't vote. We know that, right? I don't know why the mayor hasn't made changes, but whatever. Those of you who vote, basically you vote Democrat. So why would you not select New Bedford for a place for new taxes and new tolls, right? After all, we need a new bridge. They don't have any money at the state. They know that you won't vote against them or you won't vote at all. See how this works, folks? It's not too hard to figure out what their plans are. But you can stymie their plans to take from your wallet by electing a Republican to the House of Representatives this year. You're going to have an option. You have two very fine Republican candidates running out of Fairhaven, Marion, Rochester, Mattapoisett, and Acushnet, and even the far north end of New Bedford. You got two Republicans competing against each other.